Hello, good evening, good morning, and good afternoon, everyone. And I hope you're enjoying the day one of the Cultural Summit. It is indeed a jam-packed day. So my name is X Zhu-Nowell, Assistant Curator at the Guggenheim Museum in New York. And welcome to the screening of Being Human, and followed by a discussion with the artist, Christopher Kulendran Thomas, and me. Christopher Kulendran Thomas is what I believe one of the most exciting artists working today. His work often manipulates some of the structural processes by which art produces reality. The film that we're going to watch together today is actually a documentation of a film installation called Being Human. And I will later on turn it to Christopher to explain to you a little bit more about what are you looking at before we start the screening process. Shot in Sri Lanka, Being Human was made in 2019 in collaboration with Annika Coleman. It traverses between a documentary and fiction and features the artist's uncle, a family hero who founded the Center for Human Rights in the Tamil homeland of Elam, as well as various guests of the Colombo Art Biennial, including a well-known painter, a famous pop star, and a young Tamil artist. Some of these characters are actually algorithmically synthesized, which we will talk about later in our discussion. And these characters will take us, the viewer, on a journey around the island, from the fallout of the Sri Lanka Civil War to the biennial founded in its aftermath. Christopher had many solo exhibitions recently. In 2019, his solo exhibition at Schenkel Pavilion in Berlin, which is kind of the subject of the solo exhibition, is the film that we'll be watching today. And he also had a solo exhibition in the Institute for Modern Art in Brisbane, Spike Island in Bristol, and Tensta Kunsthall in Stockholm. His work has also been included in many biennials, including the 7th Bi-City Biennial in Shenzhen, the 11th Guangzhou Biennial, the 9th Berlin Biennial, and the 3rd Dhaka Art Summit, all in 2016. He also have exhibited in various international museums and institutions. You have access to his full bio on the Cultural Summit website, so I will not recite all of them to you. However, I do want to mention that Being Human is currently on view at the De Young Museum in San Francisco as part of the group exhibition, Uncanny Valley: Being Human in the Age of AI. It will also be featured in Christopher's upcoming solo projects at Institution of Contemporary Art in London and also the new VAC Museum in Moscow. I know many cities are recently opened up, so if you're in San Francisco, London, or Moscow, I will definitely encourage you to visit the exhibition and experience the installation in person. I was lucky enough to catch this project at the Schenkel Pavilion in Berlin in 2019, right before the lockdown. A few notes before we get started. We'll first screen the film. It's about 20 minutes. And afterwards, I will lead a conversation with Christopher to dive deeper into the project. We'll also be able to take a few questions towards the end, so feel free to submit the questions directly onto the Cultural Summit website. And the Q&A function is located on the right side of your web browser. And thank you. So I will turn it to Christopher to say a few words before we get started with the screening. Thank you.
Unmute. Thanks, X, for that very generous introduction. I'll just say a quick thing about what we are going to screen. You'll be watching a documentation from a film installation, as X explained, at Schenkel Pavilion in Berlin. And you'll see the film that's part of that installation projected onto a glass screen that bisects the space. And from time to time, you'll see through that screen some of the rest of the installation there. It's a bit confusing watching the documentation of the thing, so that's why I wanted to explain.
Great. Oh my God, this is so fantastic. After 15 months of my last time watching it in person, it is equally fantastic watching it again online. It's kind of nice actually to see the effect of a screen within a screen. And where do we start? So much to talk about. Maybe I will start first by ask you, Christopher, about your background and just kind of roll it back a bit before our audience about your background and how, you know, your interest maybe in technology, AI, and et cetera, and how that has led into this particular film installation.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I grew up in London after my parents left the beginnings of the violence that would later escalate into the Sri Lankan Civil War. And so I watched that conflict unfold from a distance. Mm. And I think I kind of naively assumed that it would end with some kind of peace treaty in Oslo or somewhere, the signing of which would be presided over by some Norwegian head of state. And tragically, that isn't at all what happened. And in 2009, that war ended in really the most horrific way that I could have imagined, with the annihilation of the Tamil opposition by the Sri Lankan army and the killing of an unknown number of Tamil civilians in what has yet to be officially recognized as a genocide by the so-called international community. And at that point, I was about to start art school in London, and I saw from afar a curious thing happen in the Sri Lankan capital, Colombo. The first Western-style white cube commercial galleries opened up mm-hmm. almost overnight in the immediate aftermath of the violence that ended that war. And now, I don't know if my family hadn't left the beginnings of that conflict, I don't know if I would be an artist. But hypothetically supposing that I was, and if I was fortunate enough to be successful in that context, I mean, that's the world that I would be operating in. And so it was kind of really interesting for me to see this new regional market for contemporary art develop in the following years whilst I was at art school in London. And I kind of saw how that, how the new commercial galleries that had opened there, and then the Colombo, a Colombo art biennial, mm-hmm. how these galleries were representing a generation of Sri Lankan artists influenced somewhat by the Western art historical canon, and how this was projecting internationally liberal democratic values, whilst meanwhile the economic prosperity that this new kind of art world was built on was in a way continuing economically the kind of ethnic cleansing that had begun militarily. And so I started doing this type of work to really come to terms with the difference between where I was then and where my family were from, but yeah. in a way that was maybe truthful to the reality of what I saw as kind of conflicted about that difference. And so I used the modest budget of my degree show to purchase a couple of original artworks by some of my peers who were becoming successful in Colombo, represented by the most important new commercial gallery there. And then I presented those original works as kind of components in the installation that I made for my degree show. And that was really the beginning of the trajectory of the work that I suppose Being Human, the work that we've just screened, was really a culmination of. And you were asking specifically about AI, ML technologies. And I think that really the technologies involved in making the work were not the starting point as such. They were a means by which to think through some of the ideas in the work. And we can definitely come back to that.
Yeah, no, that's fascinating. I didn't know that actually the first step of this project was the purchasing of those peers of yours from the gallery in Sri Lanka. It's kind of fascinating. I think the viewer probably see it. It was behind a clear screen. It's almost like a show within a show. There is an exhibition inside of this installation, which I find it's very fascinating, the process of that. Maybe I want to get into the details of that a little bit later, but maybe we can just talk a bit more about the process of the work. I know there's characters, there's three different characters, right? There is, let's say, the pop star that looks like Taylor Swift. And then there is the painter that looks like Oscar Muriel. And then there's also a young artist that I don't think I know who they are yet. And so maybe tell us a bit more about, you know, I feel like there's many different strands, right? There's the kind of the social media strand, that there is a historical kind of civil war strand, and then there's a contemporary art. There's a lot of things are synthesized within this whole project. And also there's a lot of different characters are played within as well. So maybe just help us to kind of unpack that a little bit. Why you particularly choose these particular characters, or how are they built?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's so much there. And let's start with the filmmaking process itself. And the whole process really has been a big collaboration, firstly with my long-term collaborator, Annika Kuhlman, and then also with our ever-growing little family of collaborators working on everything from music, cinematography, and editing to building computers and writing algorithms. And in a way, we tried to automate any filmmaking process that we could from the algorithmically synthesized characters that you referred to, to, for example, scraping the internet for contemporary art documentation, to synthesize this homage to Arthur Jaffa's incredible work Apex, and also, for example, this pop song that's part of the soundtrack, which is not by Taylor Swift.
Oh, it was very convincing.
Do you know who Max Martin is?
I don't think so.
Well, not that many people know him by name, but everyone knows his music. He's arguably the most prolific producer of all time. And I mean, he started back in the day with like Britney and Backstreet Boys and stuff in the 90s. But but by I suppose that the high point of his output, he was, I mean, it seemed as though at one point a few years ago, it seemed as though pretty much like, I don't know, a third of the Billboard 100 any given week was either written or produced by either Max Martin or Shellback or one of their collaborators.
Oh, geez, I did not know that.
And that totally blows my mind. I mean, imagine if like half the artists in the world were all kind of like secretly produced, not represented like with a gallery, but actually like produced and authored by the same studio somewhere, right? Totally wild. And so Max Martin has this secret songwriting system that he calls melodic math, which are the rules behind his chart-topping hits. But nobody really knows what the formula is. So we worked with a composer, Aaron David Ross, to reverse engineer that formula by systematically analyzing Max Martin's Taylor Swift back catalog, and then computationally synthesizing our kind of best attempt at the ultimate Taylor Swift track, which has yet to be written, which is that song.
I think that deserved to be the Billboard Top 100. It's very convincing.
Well, yeah. I love it. It's become, I'd say it's certainly in my top five Taylor Swift, well, let's say top 10 Taylor Swift tracks for sure. And it's lyrically garbage because the lyrics are written by a computer.
So does every other pop song.
I don't know. I think Taylor Swift, songwriting is pretty extraordinary, but no, these lyrics are written by a computer and don't make any sense. But I do find it extremely gratifying when I see kids in the exhibition Shazamming it.
Yeah. So, okay.
I should get back to the characters that you asked about.
Exactly. No, but that's fascinating though. But I think, tell us, okay, you obviously have a studied Taylor Swift and has some sort of a huge fan obsession with Taylor Swift. Tell us why Taylor Swift is, especially I will say in relationship to authenticity, right? She's kind of famous for being the first one being so open with her relationships and, you know, like being authentic with her fans. So maybe tell us, maybe that answered the question, but tell us a bit more why Taylor Swift for this particular film as a character.
Well, I mean, aside from the fact that I love her music, I think what I find really kind of impressive is how her music, in a way, is also a kind of autobiographical meta reflection on how her life is narrated by others in the media, right. And I see it as a sort of way of her taking back control of the narrative. And she's basically the CEO of the whole operation of representing herself. And what I find really impressive about that is how extraordinarily relatable she makes a life that is really anything but ordinary, right? She's been training for this since her early teens. And quite often pop stars who have that kind of extraordinary life from childhood end up like total freaks. But Taylor Swift is able to, she doesn't play the kind of like pop star as cyborg or alien or whatever kind of outside of humanity. She plays a character so relatable that her fans kind of relate to her like she's their best friend.
Right, yeah.
She can have the kind of relationship with an audience that people who get paid to do marketing or whatever couldn't ever be able to do. She's able to embody that entirely. And I think this kind of contradiction, which is also what I really admire about Oscar Murillo, who I'm a massive fan of as well, is that their achievements are sold on a kind of human scale. But what I find really impressive about both of these artists is their achievement on actually a much bigger than human scale, which is, I think, really about synthesizing a complex network that they emerge from. And it's by being able to author that network that their real kind of agency is in. And yeah. So I think what they talk about in the film is really what I find really interesting about their work, but it's something that that no one could say about themselves, because it's not a human perspective to have, right, about yourself or about, you know.
Okay, that's fascinating. And I don't know if our audience noticed, because I have to admit, I wasn't 100% aware of both of these characters are synthesized, essentially. They're AI generated. Tell us a bit more about that process. And, you know, and I think the last character in this film, which I believe, maybe I was wrong, I think it's real human. It was shot in, you know, real life. Tell me about kind of the decision between having these two obviously more popular, famous characters are being synthetic, and then there's this kind of a real, and you know, and then we can get into the kind of the real and fiction kind of a conversation as well.
Yeah, well, let's start with the synthetic avatars first. We built two computers to run machine learning algorithms for quite a long time, trained on all of the available imagery online of this famous pop star and well-known Colombian painter, and yeah, that's how we that was probably the most sort of time-consuming part of the whole filmmaking process, was just running and optimizing those algorithms to synthesize those characters. The main character in the film is an Elam Tamil artist by the name of Ilavanil Jayapalan. And Ilavanil is currently living in Norway. Mm. And Ilavanil's take on the Sri Lankan art scene and what is happening on the island now is a very particular one that is probably only possible from the diaspora. Mm. And his view is one that I share.
Right.
But I should point out that we wouldn't be able to make that film if we lived in the Tamil homeland. Mm. Right? It was I mean, scary enough for us to shoot this film in the north under a condition of fairly militarized or highly policed situation there. But and that's maybe become even more so since. But I mean, certainly if we lived there, we just wouldn't make that film. That would be kind of suicidal of us. And so, yeah, it's a particular position that is necessarily from a distance, in a way.
Yeah, okay. Maybe let's get into the kind of human rights question a bit, because I think the beginning of the film talk traced kind of a history of human rights, and especially you talked about the relationship between human rights and sovereignty and a nation state. Maybe just tell us a bit more. I mean, I'm very curious about your thesis, I guess, on human rights. And I also very curious about your thesis on what is human, because I think that has also been discussed in the film as well.
What is human? That is a brilliant question. I mean, I think when we use that word, we usually refer to a lot more than simply a biological category. I think we actually refer to a particular idea of what it means to be human, which comes from the West and has been concretized in law, and and that includes the juridical framework of human rights, which in a way is the legal front line of an empire. And in my family's homeland, in 2009, that liberal democratic conception of human rights was part of the problem rather than the solution. Mm. And it was insufficient to prevent genocide. In that, like contemporary art, which I kind of see as the sort of aesthetic expression of the same liberal democratic values, it's based on a theoretical abstraction of equality, but that logic is not very useful for understanding how power is structured through the institutions by which that conceptual projection of equality is maintained. In contemporary art, that is the institutions of the art system. In terms of human rights, those institutions are nation states, often organized through representative democracies. So the film is really about that relationship between human rights and contemporary art, but seen through the prism of artificial intelligence and machine learning. And on the subject of human rights, my uncle, who you mentioned, is perhaps the fourth character in the film, who makes a cameo appearance on Skype. He, as you said, set up and ran this Human Rights Center. He's a bit of a hero in our family because he was the last to leave. He was rector of a school in Jaffna, and he wanted to stay to protect his students. And he also set up this Human Rights Center, which the government didn't appreciate much. Its purpose was to investigate government war crimes. So they tried to assassinate him three times. And really, he's the luckiest person that I know. I mean, the first time they tried to kill him, a bomb landed in his bed when he got up in the middle of the night to go to the loo.
Wow.
He has that kind of crazy luck, and he thinks God is looking after him, which seems perfectly reasonable under the circumstances. So eventually he had to leave. I mean, he refers to the third time the government tried to kill him, which is when they raided his office and shot the place up. But he'd been tipped off the previous day, so that's when he finally left, and he's now perfectly safe in Canada. And so this conversation about human rights is really this kind of long-standing one that I've been having with my uncle. I call him Father Uncle because he's a priest. In a way, the ideas of the film are a sort of extension of that conversation.
It is seemed, perhaps you can correct me if I'm wrong, you have, I think, a very nuanced understanding of kind of sovereignty or governance with individual in relationship to nation state. And I have been, in the past maybe 2 or 3 years, have been following this conversation in the crypto communities, that a lot of people are talking about the relationship between kind of the nation state versus a networked state. And I think you also mentioned that a bit too, when you mentioned, you know, AI and stuff like that. And yeah, maybe I can ask you, I think we only have a few minutes left, to kind of talk about a bit more about your interest in the alternatives to nation state. And is there any alternative? And if so, what are the alternatives? And I know you also have a project that is related to housing that maybe you want to share a bit more with our audience as well.
Yeah, totally. Maybe I'll start there. And I mean, this kind of started with the kind of work that we've been talking about. And I think what is really interesting about the contemporary art scene in Colombo is that you really get to see on fast forward how contemporary art establishes itself and works structurally, right? If you're interested in thinking of it as an art historically specific genre, in Sri Lanka, you have this accelerated microcosm to see what contemporary art does structurally with its almost like with its kind of like quasi diplomatic portfolio as part of the processes through which cities around the world are transformed. And the thing is, most art people don't like thinking about those structural processes as the consequences of contemporary art. Mm-hmm. They prefer talking about what art does for the viewer's interpretation of it. And so I guess through all this work, myself and my long-term collaborator, Annika Kuhlman, have become increasingly interested in this question of how you could do art if you took those structural processes that art is often involved in, if you took those as your intentional starting point, or even as your artistic material. And so through this, we brought together collaborators across the fields of technology, architecture, design, and art to think about how to do art-led work through these wider like structural processes. And our first the kind of project that's come out of that is as you say in the field of housing. We have started a distributed housing collective, which we've been thinking of as a kind of, I suppose, a distributed evolution of traditional models of cooperative housing. And we've been working on that with the Architecture Office OMA and with Samir Bantal, who you probably know from the wonderful Countryside exhibition at Guggenheim in New York. And with this, we're interested in a new model of collective co-ownership of housing beyond national borders. And we're at the very beginning of what will be a long journey with this. But what started as an artistic proposition has kind of got real with now 150 homes that we're signing up across like 5 different locations. And so this will also be somewhat the basis of like subsequent exhibitions.
That's, really fantastic. I'm very curious because, I mean, thinking about the process, like what you're talking about, the kind of art historical process or kind of the genealogies or progression of art from, you know, the modernist art for art's sake to today, now almost like I feel like you're using the avatar of art, but actually do the real work, which is fascinating. And I know we are at time, and I have received one question, actually multiple questions, but maybe this was a quick one you can address in the 30 seconds kind of manner, is how has the pandemic influenced your work? And I think it is an important one.
In so many ways. But I guess the biggest idea that is now leading a lot of our work, including the thing that we were just talking about, is that the pandemic has really kind of inflicted on the world a large scale experiment in comparative governance.
That's true.
In different jurisdictions have responded in different ways, and that's produced starkly different outcomes. And at the same time, it's also led to the mainstream adoption of remote work. Not for everyone, of course, and a lot of people can't work in these flexible ways, but working from home has gone mainstream. And so the question that we're kind of interested in is that if you take this experiment in comparative governance together with a now large population that are able to think flexibly about where they live, then how will this transform cities and even citizenship in the coming years?
That is fascinating note to end on. I have been told that we have to stop the live, but thank you so much, Christopher,
Thank
for
you.
your brilliance and also to share the screening with us today. And I hope everyone enjoyed the presentation and see you soon next time.
Thank you.